Thank you for joining us for the Victory Podcast today. Today's podcast is from March 5th, 2017. We continue our study in the Gospel of John with Ippolito Malloy.
We're going to be in John chapter 6, verses 16 through 21. John chapter 6, verses 16 through 21. All right. It says, when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. And it was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. And when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were frightened. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Then they were glad to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they were going. Oh, Lord, I thank you for your word. I ask that you would speak to us through it, Lord. I pray that you would open our eyes and just help us to give you the glory. I ask all this in your name. Amen. Can you guys grab a seat, please? Well, we sure do have a lot of kids here. Oh my gosh. I know it seems like a lot when you're up there. When you're sitting in front of them, we have a lot of kids. And, you know, these kids, I just feel like they're growing up so fast. My wife and I have a set of twins, and they're 1.5 years old. And I just feel like they were born just yesterday. And every day, it just seems like they're progressing so fast. And I feel like if I'm not careful, sometimes I get in, like, this panic of, like, oh, my gosh, like, they're 1.5. Like, in, like, 4 or 5 years, they're going to be in elementary school. That just blows my mind. I mean, they're running around in their diapers, and you're like, how is this possible? It just doesn't seem to compute. And I don't know if you guys ever do this, but do you ever just look at your kids and think, like, they're picking their nose right now, and, like, in 5 years, they might have their driver's license, or maybe in 8 years, they'll be completely on their own, or maybe in a few years, they'll be going to high school or middle school, and time is short, and I feel like, in my life, I know in our lives, especially with our children, we want to make the most of everything we say, everything we don't say, and we want to make everything we do intentional, and it's a lot of pressure sometimes. And today, as we jump into this passage here, you're going to see Jesus with his disciples, and you're going to see that same sort of intentionality with him. We have in the Gospels roughly recorded 3 years of ministry of Jesus, but roughly half of that is with him and his disciples, and he's pouring into their lives, and everything he does and everything he doesn't do is significant. Now, by no means this side of heaven, I don't think we'll ever be able to understand everything that he did. I do think that everything he is doing is a teaching moment. And so today, my goal this morning is I want to study a trial that the disciples faced. A pretty common one, a pretty familiar one for all of us. But I want to, let's look at how and why the trial is there. And I hope, let's seek to understand that and apply that into our lives. So some background information on the passage. This is the same day when we start out that Dax preached on yesterday. And so, I mean, not yesterday, last Sunday. Last Sunday, so it's the feeding of the 5,000. So now it's evening, everybody's been fed, and Jesus is taking his disciples, and he goes down to the Sea of Galilee, and kind of like Dax spoke about yesterday, it's not this big, giant sea. You got to think more of like a lake. So about 17 by 14 miles, it's a freshwater lake fed by the Jordan, and it's in northern Israel. And so you look at this, So you look at the disciples, and that's kind of where we are. Feeding of the 5,000, long day. Jesus gets them, puts them in a boat, and we pick it up here in verse 16. And it says, when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into a boat, and started across the sea to Capernaum. And it was now dark, so it's now dark time, it's now evening time, and Jesus had not yet come to them. And if we go to the parallel passage over in Mark, you get a little bit more insight, and that's in chapter 6, verse 46. And quote, this is what it says, immediately he made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side. And we find this word immediately used in Matthew as well. And what we find in all three accounts, you see Jesus commanding his disciples to get into the boat, and immediately they get into the boat and they head off. And you don't see anywhere here in the accounts of the disciples arguing with him, stalling, doing anything. They're being 100% obedient. Jesus says, do it. He gives them the command. They obey. and it's there's nothing else. It's complete obedience on their part. And let's not forget that when we look at this, that Jesus is the one sending them to go across. And the thing is Jesus, we know the story. Jesus knows a storm is coming. And I think what we can really get from this is you can be completely in God's will, completely obedient, and head right into a storm in life, right into a trial in life. And as easy as that is to say and go, yeah, of course, that's right. Even though it's like an intellectual thing we know, I think a lot of times as believers, we forget that. We forget that once we follow Jesus, life is not perfect. I want to clarify the difference between this trial, which I want to call a perfection trial, a trial where Jesus purposely will send you into something to mold you, change you, make you draw close to him, and then a trial based on a result of sin. And so a lot of times those get mixed up. There's trials we have in life that are based solely on poor decisions. And I don't want you guys to think about this. So whether you make a poor decision on a weekend, like on a Saturday night, and then you have some consequences of that, that's not what we're talking about here. That's not a perfection trial. Or maybe you're just a stinker to everybody at work and kind of a goober, and then you're like, well, everybody's mean to me at work. I don't understand why. That's not a perfection trial. That's just the natural consequence of kind of being a goober. It just is. But some people be like, oh, God's really putting me through stuff. Like, no, man, you're just not very nice. Like, there's no way around it. But what we're speaking about here is we're speaking about a trial that God puts us in purposely because of our obedience. And if we look at the Bible, they are filled with them. I mean, just some ones that we are all very familiar with. Noah, okay, I want you to spend a large majority of your life building a boat, this giant boat, which I assume would be to the ridicule of everyone around him, you know? Or if we look at Abraham, you got to wait 100 years to finally have a child, and then God says, hey, I want you to sacrifice him to me. Or to Moses, we can look at Moses. Okay, here you go. I want you to lead millions of people out of an empire who use these people as their slave workforce. There's another huge trial that we see in there. Or Jeremiah, I want you to preach for 40 years with not one recorded conversion. Or the Apostle Paul, and I'll read this out of 2 Corinthians 11. And this is where the Apostle Paul talks about his life and what he experienced as someone who was completely obedient to the Lord. And this is what he says, quote, five times I received at the hands of the Jews 40 lashes, lest one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I was adrift at sea, on frequent journeys, in dangers from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers, in toil and hardship through many a sleepless night, in hunger and thirst, often without food and cold and exposure. And apart from other things, there is the daily pressure on me of my anxiety for all the churches. And that right there is not a verse you hear right before an altar call, am I right? Like, nobody reads off that and says, and who would like to receive Jesus Christ? It's just not something common. But you know what I love about Jesus, though? And I love this about our Lord, is he's very upfront with us. There's no lying. There's no being sneaky. He's very upfront. You know, when Jesus used this right here, when he was doing his altar call, take up your cross and follow me. You know, if you took up your cross, that means you were on your way to die. And I want us to understand that the Lord's being very upfront with us in our lives. When we follow him, we have these trials. We have these hard times. That's a natural part of being a believer. And life is filled with them. I mean, every single day, every single week, I feel like in life, either you're going into the trial or you're coming out of a trial. It's just one or the other, or you're in the midst of a trial. And that's kind of how it is. And I feel like, unfortunately, in our country especially, you will see a lot of people saying that once you follow Jesus, everything will be perfect. It's like kind of like Jesus is like this magic rabbit foot. You put him in your pocket and then everything is just like smooth sailing. Now, I know following the Lord has some natural blessings that accompany it. You know, if you're not murdering, your life will probably be a little bit better. You know, if you're not out there committing adultery, if you're not doing these things that God wants to stay away from, there will be a quality of life that is better. But by no means does that mean that everything is going to be perfect. So you can look at the Bible and you can see very plainly in the disciples' lives, in many stories, trials are, it's a part of being a believer. It's just part of being a Christian. But I want to look at is what should our perspective be when a trial happens to us? And you can see up here, they already threw it on the screen, James 1, chapter 2. And this is supposed to be our perspective in trials. And it says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet kinds of various trials. Joy. That's what we're supposed to experience. When you get into a trial, the first response should be, man, you should be experiencing joy. So I looked up what that word joy meant in the original Greek. And it is the word, my notes are all moved up. It's the word kara. And do you know what that really means? It means joy. That's exactly what it means. There's nothing tricky about it. It means joy. We're supposed to be excited about joy. Now, I hate to admit this, but when I experience a trial, and you can ask my wife, it's not my first natural reaction. Now, hopefully someday the Lord will mature me enough to where I know he's changing in my life, but it's not. And I experience a lot of things, and usually in this order, and maybe you guys can relate to some of them. The first thing I think, that's pretty common, I'm like, is this happening because I did something wrong? I think back, like, am I doing something wrong in my lives? And then I think, God, can this wait until next year? Like, kind of got a busy schedule, kind of a lot going on. And then I accept it, and then I say, God, okay, how long is this going to last? Let's get, just give me a time limit, I can handle it. And then I start thinking, man, is there no other way really to be like Jesus? You know, do we have to go through these trials? And then I usually think, if I don't pass this, am I going to have to repeat this again? Then the pressure starts coming on. And then finally, I feel like God gets a hold of me and he's like, okay, Hippolyto, you're supposed to be experiencing joy. But why joy? Like when we face trials, they're not comfortable. They're not fun. I'm not going to stand up here and pretend that I'm some super spiritual guy that as soon as a trial hits, I'm like, yeah. But there is a reason, and it's a great reason. If we finish this passage here, go to the next slide, please. Let's finish it out. It says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. And that word steadfast, some of you might have heard this before. It's usually thrown around in sermons, the word hupomone. And it's a really neat word. It means to remain under pressure. It means when pressure comes that you remain. And it's not this remaining, just grit your teeth and bear it. Like I'm a believer and I'm just going to grit my teeth because we just need to suffer through this life. It's remaining under pressure. It's going through it knowing that the Lord is changing you. That the Lord is testing your faith. The Lord is making you want to lean in towards him. He's redirecting your focus. So yes, is it hard? Yes. But it's not this just grin and bear it. Oh, I'm just going to just go through this tough life. Like there's a reason for it. As believers, we need to know that. Like God is genuinely using all of these experiences for our betterment. So why joy when these inevitable trials come to us, says Jesus' fathers? And it's joy because we know Jesus loves us enough to not leave us how we are. It's joy because we know Jesus is in the process of changing us. It's joy because we can trust someone who died so we can have eternal life. And it's joy because he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. And so we see that trials are something in the life of a disciple, in the Bible, life of a believer. But another thing that you'll see with these trials, as crazy as they sound, God uses trials a lot of time to protect us. And you can see this here. If you have your Bibles open, if you go back to John 6:15, the verse right before that we're starting, you can see that the crowd who just ate the loaves and the fish, they're wanting to make Jesus their earthly king. And Dax touched base on this last Sunday a little bit. But this crowd, and we say, it says the feeding of the 5,000, they were counting men, so 15, 20,000, bigger than the size of Hermiston, all wanting to make, huge crowd, Jesus their king. And if you look in Mark and Matthew, we had talked about this earlier, that immediately is the word that Jesus that they use in the Bible, that Jesus gets them immediately, he sends them across. And I think what he's doing is he's protecting them. I think he really is protecting them. And I think this is why. First, Jesus did not come to set up a kingdom here on earth. You know, he came to die on the cross. He came to pay the price for our sins. He came to reestablish what was broken back in Genesis and has been broken ever since. And Jesus came to restore, and that was his mission. And Jesus even openly spoke about this in John 18. And Jesus said this, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews, but my kingdom is not of this world. And so, end quote on that. And so, yes, the whole world belongs to Jesus. Yes, he created the world. We know that. You know, it speaks about that in Colossians. It speaks about that in Genesis. It speaks about that in John. But what he's saying here is Jesus did not come to bring these literal armies and conquer this world and set up the world. That is not his purpose. And the crowd is misled. You see that. The crowd is misled. And even later on, you find out that the crowd is actually coming to him because the crowds, they want to be fed. I mean, that's their reason to come to him. They want a free meal. And so they have this totally wrong mindset set when they come to him. And second, the second thing we see why Jesus is, how he's protecting his disciples as he sends them off, is the disciples have not matured to a level where they would not be affected by these misled masses. I mean, you have to picture this. And we do this, I'm a third grade teacher, and so we do a lot of this when we read stories. We practice visualizing what we're reading. But you have to picture 15, 20,000 people all have just been fed, all have seen this amazing miracle. Obviously, there's this mob mentality, and they're all going, yeah, let's make this guy our king. We're getting a free meal out of this. Like, this is awesome. And the disciples, they're just not ready for that pressure. I don't think they are there yet. And I'm not picking on the disciples. I don't want you guys to think that. Eventually, they all become great men of faith, you know, recorded in church history. Every, minus Judas, every single one of them will die for their faith except for John. I mean, these guys ended up becoming just pillars of faith as Jesus molded them, as they received the Holy Spirit, and as their lives went on. But here, they're not there yet. And you can even see accounts of, in the Gospels, of the disciples actually arguing amongst themselves who's the greatest. I mean, they actually have these. You got to picture this. This is grown men sitting around arguing who is the greatest of them. And we read that and we're like, oh, okay, that kind of sounds weird. But what if you pictured it like this? What if, say, midweek, you got to stop by the church for something, and you come in and you're like, oh, there's a meeting going on. You see Dax and the elders, they're all sitting around a table, and you're like, wow, that's like a pretty heated meeting. Like, something must have happened midweek. Maybe they're fighting over doctrine. I don't know what's going on. And you get a little closer and you start listening, and you're like, what? They're like listing off accomplishments and awards and things they got. And you get closer, like, oh my gosh, these guys are arguing who the greatest of them is. I mean, you would never probably come back to this church. You would walk out and you'd be like, I am gone. Like, that would be it. I assume that's what I would do anyways. I mean, I'd be out of here. And so when you picture it like that, it's a little bit different. Like, these guys are just not there yet. And I think Jesus understands that. And what he's doing is he's protecting them. He's getting them out of that situation. And he's doing all these other things too. But I think one of the things he's doing is he's getting them out of this situation. You have this mob mentality. And he wants to get him away. He needs some time with the Father, and he sends them off. And he sends them off with that. I think God does protect us until we have a greater understanding of him. Last week we had a sunny day, kind of like today. And now that we have Canadian winters, I wanted to make the most of the sunny day. So my days, it's rough, I know. So my day's wrapping up. And my day's wrapping up at school. I got a few minutes left. So send a message to the babysitter. Hey, if the kids are up, get them ready. I'm taking them to the park. So I rush home, change out, get the kids ready, get them in the stroller. We head over to the park. And I'm like, all right. It's a sunny day. We got the park to ourselves. I get the kids in the stroller. You know, I'm just looking forward to this. Get them out of the stroller. And we got the beautiful play structure all to ourselves. Sun is shining. And where do the kids go? They want to run into the street. They just want to head off into danger. And it's like whatever has the highest percentage chance of mortally wounding them, that's what they are drawn to. And it's without fail. I don't understand why it works this way. But I will chase after them. I grab them and I turn them back. I'm like, no, look, a toy structure is better than the street. And like, they get mad and my daughter like flails and my wife knows what I'm talking about. And she like screams and she doesn't understand. And she's mad at me. She's like, why are you turning me away from the street? I want to play in the street. Why are you making me go to the play structure? And I think the application is very easy to see in our lives. Like, a lot of times we're running towards stuff that is going to hurt us, and our Father knows best. And a lot of times we're like those little kids. We're kicking and screaming, and we don't understand, and it doesn't make sense, and this is uncomfortable. But the Lord knows. I mean, he really does know us, and he really does know what's best for us, and that's powerful to see. You know, I think he created us. He has been working to restore relationships with us. And he's been protecting his children for thousands of years. So when we find ourselves in those storms, And maybe some of this makes sense to you. Maybe you realize, man, God has sent me into a trial because he's protected me. Some of you this morning probably know, you can look in your history, if God would not have done this in my life, I probably would have ended up in this where I shouldn't have been. I probably would have followed that trial, followed that temptation. And I think for a lot of us, we will never know the side of heaven, how much God protects us. Just like my children don't know. They don't understand what I'm doing. And when they get older, they probably won't understand as well. But that doesn't negate the fact that I love them, and that even greater than that, our Father loves us and wants to be in our lives. The next thing we see in this passage, and we're going to go to chapter 6, verse 18, is that trials reveal our faith. Trials reveal our faith. It says, the sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing, and when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were frightened. But he said to them, it is I, do not be afraid. Then they were glad to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land which where they were going. And in Mark 6:48, it tells us that it was about the fourth watch, or about, which would be about 3 a.m. in the morning when Jesus approaches them. And so since Jesus told them to cross, if we look back in the passage, and he told them to cross around evening time, approximately 9 hours they have been out on the sea. And that's after the long day with the full feeding of the 5,000. You got to imagine how exhausting that would be with 15 to 20,000 people passing out the food, dealing with their requests, all the problems that come with that. And then at the end of that, they embark on this 9-hour rowing across the lake. It says there's wind, there's waves. They were terrified. And it's very, very exhausting in this. It's very exhausting in that. And I think a lot of times we can just read that and move on. But I think we need to appreciate what that is there. It's 9 hours of manual labor after a long day, 9 hours of waves soaking. You know they already got to be wet, soaking wet there in the middle of the night, and 9 hours of wind in their face. And I think this is one of the things that we see in trials and why God allows those in our lives is he wants them to come to the end of their resources. I really do believe that. You've already had a long day. You have 9 hours of rowing. It's in the dark, you're wet, you're cold, you're probably miserable. They probably understand they're only around halfway across. There probably feels like there's no solution in this. And I think he's allowing them to a place where they can be broken. 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, examine yourselves to see whether you are in the faith. It says, examine yourselves to see whether you're in the faith. And I think that's what he's doing this with them here. And you know, It's really difficult sometimes, I think, to examine to see whether we are in the faith. Are we living for the Lord? Are we really placing our faith in him? Especially when things are going good. Because when stuff's going good, I don't know, I think we have this kind of tendency to just not lean on the Lord as hard. You know, when everything's going night, if it's a nice sunny day and you're rowing across the boat, you might be like, oh, all right, it's a nice day. But in the middle of a storm, in the middle of the night, I think God is allowing them to examine themselves and to let them see where they place their faith. And what's interesting about this is not the first time that they've been in a storm with Jesus. In Mark 4, if you guys look back and you can check this out sometime, but they were in a similar storm with him. And a lot of you know the story where Jesus was in the boat that time and he was sleeping in the bow and there was a storm and they were panicking and they were freaking out. And they freak out. He wakes up, he rebukes the wind, and the storm stops. And God's, what he's doing is he's revisiting this again. He's testing their faith. Hey, we've done this before. I stopped the storm before. Now you're in that again. I told you to go across, which means you should trust me on my word. You should be to the other side just fine. But they're freaking out. And I don't think they have this full understanding of him. One of the more interesting parts in the parallel passage in Mark 6, verses 51, 52. So this is the parallel passage about this. And I love what this says here. It says that once Jesus enters the boat and he calms the storm, this is in Mark 6, 51, 52, it says this quote, they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. And I'll say that again. It says, the disciples, they were utterly astounded, for they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened. So Jesus enters the boat, storm stops, and they're astounded. And why? Because they didn't understand about the loaves and their hearts were hardened. Well, the question is, well, what are they not understanding about the loaves? And why are their hearts hardened? Like, what is going on here? What are they not getting that Jesus is trying to relay to them? He's already had them go through this storm once. This is the second time. What are they not understanding? And I think I spent a lot of time on this one part of the passage these last few weeks. And I really think, and I really truly believe, what they do not understand is who Jesus is. I don't think they understand his character. I don't think they fully understand his mission. I don't think they fully understand his heart for people, that he is fully God, that he can walk on water, and that's no big deal because he's fully God, that he can take a couple fish and some loaves and create however much food that he wants. I don't think they're fully understanding who he is. And I think that incomplete understanding of who Jesus is causing them a lot of problems. And Jesus is driving that message home. This is who I am. This is who I am. This is who I am. And he's trying to drive it home to them, and they're not getting it. And I think, I really truly believe, this is a major thing in our Christian lives, is not understanding who Jesus is can not only make this Christian life confusing, but downright terrifying. And I'll say that again. Not understanding who Jesus is, his character, his mission, his love for us, will make this Christian life confusing and it downright terrifying. And I think as believers, we have to know who Jesus is. I mean, yes, we come to church on Sunday. Yes, we get together as believers. But if we are not diving into his word, if we are not always pursuing to know more about our Savior, life doesn't make sense. I mean, he created this world. He created us. Every day he wants to be intentional in our lives. And I miss it all the time. I'll be honest. There's so many things I'm sure the Lord is trying to do. And he's like, all right, let's repeat it again, Hippolito. Let's try it again. But I think just as he was intentional here with these disciples, I think he really wants to be intentional in our lives daily. And I think we miss it because we don't know who he is a lot of times. We forget that he's loving and he's kind and he's compassionate and he wants to have this relationship with us. And he's currently standing next to the Father interceding for us daily. You know, as we keep those things in our mind, trials are different. Our days are different. Our life is different because we have that understanding of who he is. There's a passage here, Psalm 9. There we go. It says, "The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble, and those who know your name put their trust in you. For you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you." I'll say that again. The Lord is a stronghold for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble, and those who know your name put their trust in you, for you, O Lord, have not forsaken those who seek you. And I think when we are in the storms of life, when we have those trials like the disciples, these are the things we hold on to. We hold on to these promises of God, because just like it says in here, those who know your name put their trust in you. And I don't believe that's like, you know Jesus' name is Jesus. That's not what it's talking about there. It's the idea of, you know what that name of Jesus holds into it. What does that mean when you say the name Jesus? Who's behind that name? What is his character? Who is he? And those who know your name, they put their trust in you. And why? Because, O Lord, you have not forsaken those who seek you. Now, I know not everything this side of heaven makes sense. I know that. And I know not every trial will make sense and everything in our lives, but I think we can trust in a Savior who has proved himself, not only through his word, but in our daily lives. And if we look back, we can see him very active in that, which is a neat thing to see in there. And I just think those are very powerful verses, and I think that's good for us to see. And finally, I want to look at the actions of Jesus that reveal his character as the disciples face this storm. Now, there's not a lot of time to go through each one of these, but I think it's important to stop and look. How did Jesus respond in this passage in John 6? Like, what were his actions when the disciples were in the storm? And I'll be pulling some of the verses from some of the parallel passages as well. And if we look at all the accounts in all the Gospels, this is what we learn. And the first one is this, is that Jesus intercedes for us. You can see this in Mark 6:46. And then obviously it talks about in Hebrews 7, how we have an advocate, we have a Lord that is interceding for us. And in the passage when the disciples are out there, if you look in Mark, you can see Jesus is praying. And he's up on the hill and it says that he can see them and he's praying. Now, it doesn't say specifically he's praying for them, but we know that the Father stands at the right hand and he's interceding for us all the time. And I believe he was there. He was praying for them. And the application is simple. In our trials, we're not alone. We have the Father who's interceding for us. He's standing at the right hand right there. The second thing you see there is that Jesus is attentive to our situation. In Mark 6:48, in the parallel passage, it says that his eyes were on them, that during the storm, he could see them. Now, that's supernatural. It's the middle of the night. They're a few miles out onto the lake. But Jesus is actually seeing them in the storm. And I don't know if that's comfort for you, but I feel like a lot of times in trials, it's really easy to feel isolated, to feel alone. But knowing not only that the Father's interceding for us, but that the Father has his eyes on us, you know, that God can see us in our trial and that we're not alone. It's not just us and our Bible, and we're just going to just pull up our bootstraps and we're just going to go forward. But God is with us during that time, and he sees us, and he knows those things. So when we do come to him in prayer and we do ask him for guidance, for support, he knows, you know, he knows that. The next thing we see is that in John 6:19, is we see that Jesus comes to us in our trials. You know, Jesus doesn't come out walking, doesn't yell to them from the shore like, hey, God helps those who help themselves. Like, you know, it's not like this. Hey, you do half and I'll do half. Like, they're at their wit's end. I'm sure after 9 hours, I'm sure a lot of them were ready to give up. Heck, a few of them might even have stopped rowing and be like, you guys, there's no point in this. You never know. But he comes to them in their time of need. And he doesn't beat them up, and he has compassion on them. And he meets them in their trials. And finally, we find also that Jesus can stop the storm. Now, I'm not saying that Jesus will make every single bad thing in our lives go away. I'm not saying that. But I think it's important to know that even as he stopped the storm here in their lives, that there is an end point to our storms. God has a purpose for them. There is a season for that, but there is an end point. For me, that gives me comfort that, okay, God, you know me, and there is going to be an end point. And for some of our storms, maybe those don't end until we stand face to face to him, you know, and that's a reality. I'm not going to say that Jesus will just solve anything like a magic rabbit foot, like, oh, he'll stop the storm. Yes, he does. He does meet us in those trials, but there is an end point, you know. There is a day where we will be in heaven with our Father, and we won't have to worry about these anymore, but we're not there yet. And, you know, he's still working on us and he's still trying to change us. And one last thing I want to talk about in this passage. In John 6:20, the only part where Jesus is speaking in here, his only dialogue, he says, it is I, do not be afraid. He says that. He goes, hey, it is I, do not be afraid. And what Jesus is literally saying, he's saying, I am. Back when Moses went to the burning bush and God said, I am, he's saying, I am. I'm God. He's letting him know, I am God. This is me, God, fully man, standing in front of you. And then he says, take courage. So what he's saying here literally is, I am God, understand who I am. And then he's saying, because of that fact, what I want you to do, I want you to take courage. I want you to take courage with that. And I think that the lesson is learned by these disciples. And I think they're starting to understand that God loves us, protects us, provides for us. And even though we go through storms, that he loves us. And I think they get this too for a couple reasons. One, you'll see here next week in the passage when Dax speaks about the masses coming back and Jesus gives this whole bread of life discourse. He makes it very difficult and a lot of people leave. Not to be a spoiler, but all the crowds leave. Jesus makes it very, very hard. And I love what Peter says. When Jesus says, are you guys going to leave too? And he goes, where are we going to go? You have the words to eternal life. So I think they're starting to get it. And I think the other reason that I know they get it is if you look at the parallel passage in Matthew, this is the first recorded spot where the disciples worship Jesus. It's the first place in the Gospels where they sit down and they must fall on their faces and they must worship him. And I think they get it. They're starting to understand, okay, you are God. You're fully God. You love us. Walking on water is no big deal for you. Creating all this food is no big deal for you. You can heal. You can cast out demons. Like, they're starting to get it. You are fully God. And they worship him. And it's a beautiful picture to see that. And I think they finally understand that. And I think they finally came to the end of their rope there. Now, they still make mistakes. You can still read them making a lot of mistakes, and so do we. But I think they finally get it. And I think as believers, when we fully understand Jesus is God, when we fully understand who he is, I think that's our only response. We should worship our God with our lives, with our words, with our thoughts, with our actions. And so let us be our response today as we go into this week. You know, as we search the scriptures to get to know him, you know, as he speaks to us through his trials, you know, and as I was continually preparing us for eternity with him, let us worship our King.
We would like to thank you for joining us for the Victory Podcast today. This podcast is a ministry of Victory Baptist Church in Hermiston, Oregon. You can find us at 193 East Main Street in Hermiston, Oregon, 97838, or on the web at yourvictory.org.